Welcome to DCS SA-342 Gazelle M Startup Training. I'm Top Gun with the AKA War Dog Squadron. I'll start off with a couple notes here. There is a separate startup training mission that I've made earlier that's strictly for the Lima and the Mistral models. There is just enough different in the cockpit for the Michael version compared to the other two that this kind of merits its own startup video. So that's why I'm doing two separate ones, even though they're the same chassis. As always, the text that you see in my checklist that are in red, anything that's in red font, are items that are already set to their to the correct positions for doing a startup for a new aircraft. So if you're spawning in for the first time, you can skip over those steps that are already set, right? But if you come in to get rearmed, refueled, repaired, you shut down your engine and you have to restart, those will be steps that you want to go through and verify those are in the correct spots. Also, if you see anything in blue text, those are items that will generally be conducted from the co-pilot seat, which is the left seat. Pilot is on the right. Just as a side note, if you want, you can turn on the body for the co-pilot. It's not required in any way, shape, or form. And if you go to the exterior view, F2, you'll see that he's already there. You just can't see him from inside the cockpit. Also, bear in mind, this is a multi-crew capable aircraft, which means that the other players on the server, if they have the SA-342 module, they can attempt to join you in your aircraft, just basically ride shotgun. If they decide to do that and they click on your aircraft, you'll get a pop-up message somewhere on your screen basically telling you that someone's trying to join your aircraft and you need to interact with that window and either basically accept or deny it. So, and anyways, with that out of the way, I am going to be operating today off of checklist version 1.6. And let's go ahead and get started. The cockpit doors do not appear to be clickable in this module, so you'll need to keybind them. The default is right control C's in Charlie. And let's go ahead and put power to the aircraft. So we got battery and alternator and generator. And then we can go to panel lights up to on. Or if it's a dusk or evening mission, you can turn on this rheostat right here to turn on UV lighting, so it'll make it night vision goggle compatible. I think at this point in time, some of the versions of the Gazelle do not have the option to have night vision goggles, even though it may show up in the keybinding menu. It's not actually active. I don't know if they're going to make it active at a later time or not. So, also, I think this version of the SA-342 is the only one that actually has laser range finding, which is mainly used to gauge whether or not you're in range for the hot missiles. I may have stated in the other Gazelle video to flip up the cover for the laser arm switch, and that may be kind of a moot point in that aircraft, but in this one you will need it. So, anyways, continuing on, I'm at Area 51, so I need to set to 118 for the radio. And in this version of the Gazelle, the hotspot for turning on the radio power by the right rotary is down near the bottom. It's a little tricky to get to. There we go. If you got it turned on successfully, you'll see a little green light here. And in the Lima and the Mistral, the hotspot is up over the top of it. So let's go ahead and contact ATC for startup clearance. So / to bring up your comms menu, and then F5 for ATC, F1 for your current airfield, and F3 for start.
Springfield, 1-1, request startup.
So let's go ahead and flip up the navigation to flash, which is the up position. an anti-collision. We'll put that into day mode, so that's also the up position. And formation lights is over your head. That's in the forward position. And just another side note, this may look a little bit different compared to my other Gazelle video, because in the first one I was doing it in DCS 1.5 and doing it with medium graphics effects, and in this one I'm in Nevada in DCS 2.1 and I've got graphics set to maximum, with the exception of beveled, I think it's the new shader, so I've left that one off because I've heard that there's been some problems with it for the moment. So if it looks a bit different graphically, that's why. So let's go ahead and turn on our fuel pump, and when you do that, you want to go ahead and hack the stopwatch on your clock, because you need to give the fuel pump at least a good 20 seconds to warm up and get things moving before you can start the engine. While it's doing that, if you want, you can go ahead and turn on the sand filter if you have one mounted. I had one mounted in the previous video. In this one, I do not. So you can kind of go back to the other video and compare what it looks like in the F2 to this. And you see that there's no big bulge just aft of the rotor disc. So basically in between the rotor and the exhaust, there's a big bulge there if you've got the sand filter equipment mounted. So since I don't have that, I'll be skipping that, but that's right here if you do have it mounted on your helicopter. If you're doing a dusk or evening mission, you can turn on your landing light, which is this switch into down position to extend it, because it's normally flush in the fuselage, and then the switch right next to it into the up position to turn it on. And now that we've been more than 20 seconds with the fuel pump, we can go ahead and start the engine with right-clicking on the switch to the up on position, and keep your eye on the engine gauge. And once the engine is stabilized, we'll zoom out a little bit here. We'll grab the rotor brake, which is this really large lever, push this forward into the off position. And now we want to go ahead and start turning up the fuel flow. And just like in the other version of the Gazelle, this is an important step. You don't want to advance this too far too fast, or you'll potentially blow the engine. So you want to move this forward about 2 or 3 inches, just enough to get the rotor starting to spin, and then stop. Don't move it any further. And what we're looking for here is we want to wait until this small needle catches up to the big one and they synchronize. Once they have, then you can go ahead and start proceeding to push it up the rest of the way. Just do it an inch or two at a time and stop for a moment to give the engine a time to catch up. And just keep repeating the process until it's fully up. And the consequence is if you push this up too far too fast, you will blow the engine. Generally speaking, anything mounted to the right side of the aircraft will probably be blown off, and your engine will be effectively destroyed, so you'll need to get a new chopper. All right, now that the engine is started, go ahead and turn on the pitot heat up to on, and then the trimmer up to on, and magnetic brake also up to on, and gyro is this rotary over here. You want to right click on this to get it up to the 12 o'clock position. And finally the autopilot power up to on, and then you've got the sub channels. So you've got pitch and roll and yaw. Then for your radar altimeter, you want to mouse wheel over the lower left knob to turn that system on, and then click and hold and move the mouse up and down to move your minimum altitude warning indicator. Now at this point, you can go ahead and right click on the lower rotary on your nadir to get it started warming up, and this will take about 2 minutes or so. So we'll continue on, and then we'll come back to this once it's ready. Go ahead and reset your ADI. So click and hold on the bottom right button here until this stops moving. And for the nav mode rotary, go ahead and rotate this all the way over to DOP, which stands for Doppler. Go ahead and uncage your backup ADI. I have to do click and hold both the left and the right mouse button at the same time, and then mouse wheel in order to scroll this down and get it centered. On your radar warning receiver, go ahead and right click on the switch to the middle position for on. And down here next to your left knee, you've got your flare panel. Right click on the switch to turn this on. You should see a number of lights show up. Now at this point, we need to switch over to the co-pilot seat. And we need to turn on the sight power. So up to on. And VCB power, just left click that to the end position for on. Infrared system power, go ahead and right click on this twice to the M position for on. And this part will take probably about 2 minutes for the IR system to cool down before it's functional. And camera position, I tend to just do two clicks to the V position, which is travel mode, where the camera is still pointed to the aft. But if you want, at this point, you can go ahead and just click it one more time, and that'll put it into on mode. Now let's switch back to the pilot seat, and let's turn our navigation on to steady to show people around us that we are ready to go. At this point, you can contact ATC for taxi and takeoff clearance. I'll go ahead and continue on with the post-takeoff checklist, just so you can see what we need to do once you're up and running. So if you've got your sand filter installed and you've got it on at this point, once you've taken off, you can turn that off. So put that back into the down position. Same thing with landing lights. Go ahead and press this into the up position to retract it. And then put the switch into the down position to turn that off. You'll want to turn your weapons on with the master armament switch. Put that into the up and on. And then we'll need to switch back over to the co-pilot seat. And we've got the lazing button cover here. I turn the covers up for stuff that I need. That way I can just key map just the active button. I don't have to worry about the covers. Same thing goes for the missile launch button cover. So that's down here, so flip that cover up. Weapon mode key. You have to kind of tilt a little off to the left here. You've got two positions here. Got the off, and you've got jour, which is daytime, and one more click will put it into night. So generally speaking, you're going to be doing the upper right position, so you'll be seeing that green light there. And in this one, the hardpoint selector, instead of being on the center console, is over here. You really have to crane to the left to see it. And when you've got a hardpoint selected that has an active weapon, you'll see a light show up here. Now, one important note is that the hot missiles are wire guided. They have a maximum range of 4.2 kilometers, which is why you have your laser distance range finder. You can tell whether or not you're in range or not to hit. But the thing that's important to note is that you can only have one missile at a time in the air. If you fire one missile and it's in flight, and you switch this hard point to the next missile, it automatically cuts the wire and you will lose control of the first missile that's in flight. So you want to make sure that you prosecute your targets one at a time. So fire, wait until impact, and then you can move on to the next hard point. Let's go ahead and switch back over to the pilot position and flip this cover up here. This is your flare dispense switch, so you want to have that cover up as well, so you can just map the flare dispense button. And now that the warnings are disappeared off of the nadir, we can finish the setup of that. The parameter switch rotary is already in the appropriate position in the BUT, but the lower rotary will want to right-click once to get into the terra position, which will show you the current location coordinates. Also, one little note I failed to mention in the previous video is this is a French helicopter, and like the other French aircraft in DCS, so the other SA-342s and the Mirage 2000, is this aircraft does not work off of traditional degrees, minutes, seconds. This works off of degrees, minutes, decimals. So the seconds have been converted to a decimal number for the minutes. So instead of 14 minutes and 30 seconds, it's 14 minutes, 0.5. So bear in mind, if you're getting coordinates off of your F-10 map and it's in degrees, minutes, seconds, you will have to do some conversions before you plug them into the nadir. But that will be, I'll go into that in greater depth at a later video. But at this point, you are pretty much good to go. Contact ATC for taxi and takeoff clearance, and you should be all set. As always, if you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. I hope this has been helpful. Thank you.